to be a habit. How you all well? How you all well and gathered here today? Lovely to see you. I'm sure, do you know, it feels just like this morning, doesn't it? Feels just like this morning since we last met. I'm going to have to just give this a twiddle. I feel like I'm talking to the top of my head. That's better. I mean, I know I often talk to the top of my head, but... Can you hear this? They're both saying I talk out of the top of my head. I don't know. What a pair. Right, so are we ready to rock and roll then? So, for anybody that might be stumbling across this on replay, welcome to Visit Fylde Coast. Visit Fylde Coast is the home of all things to do with the Blackpool area coastline. So we've got Fleetwood in that direction, and we've got Blackpool and St Anne's and Lytham and whatnot in that direction. And we make interesting, lots of interesting videos about all kinds of things. So if you want to know all about the interesting stuff and the history and beach and whatnot for the Fylde Coast, you're in the right place. Make sure you've subscribed and you've hit the little bell. Don't forget the bell. David says, can I just wish everybody, say thank you for everybody who wished him to get well soon, because he was put away last week and missed us. And if you are new here in these parts, this is a lovely little community. All comers are welcome. Please join in. Please don't just sit there in silence. I wonder what that was then. I've just seen a bird fly across the top of the window on the screen as I'm talking to you. Oh, I thought I was seeing things. I probably am. So, if you are one of our community, and I bet there's quite a few of you watching with one of these, you can get yourself a Brewer Tool mug, like that one. Now today I've got tea in it. I didn't have tea in it last week. Kevin's just said to me, don't turn it upside down. So this is complete with illustrations by T-Boy. And on the other side, some more illustrations. There you go. And that's what we do. This is how we roll on a Tuesday afternoon. So if you want one of those, the link is in the description below, so you can buy your own. Specially made just for you. Must say, makes a lovely cup of tea. So you can wait until we've finished if you want, and then you can get yours ordered and you can join the gang. Anyway, on the subject of gangs, I had another idea. Now, they all run for cover when that little bell goes off over the top of my head. They all say, oh Lord, she's had another idea, what are we going to do now? Anyway, I had another idea. Obviously, we're this, yeah, it's official, we're a gang, says David. But don't all the best gang have names? I can hear T-Boy in training laughing. Yeah. Think about what T-Boy in training stands for. And if we all enjoy watching Brewer Tool, surely that makes us all bats. Daft bats? Very possibly. So if you would like to be a bat, you're in the right place. And we've all got our Brewer Tool cups. So you shall henceforth be known as bats. Which I thought was quite funny. So,
rolling upside down.
Yeah, T-Boy wants to know if you're all hanging upside down. Moving on. That's it too. Eric says the Coastal Brewsters gang. Oh, that's too sophisticated, that, Eric. We need to be a bit more down market than that. Just remember who you're talking to. Oh, and I will just say as well, as an independent little business, when you buy things like your Brewer Tool mug, everything that you contribute towards us is reinvested into making new content, so it's all much appreciated. Right, moving on, I think I'm going to sneeze, just a minute. Oh, I've got a tickle up my nose. Right, it might arrive later.
T-Boy takeover.
I must just show you this as well. I put my cup down, and I put it on my round Q-it. Now, my friend and partner in crime, David, bought me this. And it says on it, at long last, we have sufficient quantity for each of you to have your own. Guard it well. These two wits have been especially hard to come by, especially the round ones. This is a round two-wit. Oh! It's an indispensable item. It will help to become a much more efficient worker. For years, we have heard people say, I'll do this when I get a round two-wit. There you go. Now that you have a round two-wit of your very own, many things that have needed to be accomplished will get done. So there you go. That's a very important part of our office equipment, that is our round to it. I turned that up because, I'll just turn the volume off, that's it, because it's a little treat for you a little bit later on. When we get to that point in the programme, because as usual, I have an agenda, because without one, we all know that I would be sunk like a ship. So, you'll possibly join us this morning. Oh, goodness me, what's he doing? What are you doing, T-Boy, in training?
He's kicked the bucket.
I didn't know I got a bucket down there actually, but nonetheless. I'd been on the beach this morning. I don't think I've got any posters left to show you, but we're doing a Coast Watchers project, which I've been rambling on about now for what seems like forever and a day. So I sent the press release into our local paper and they're going to run it this week. And apparently they need to have proper photographs to go with it. So the Gazette photographer's been and taken a picture this morning on the beach. So while I got my coat on and was outside and cold, I thought I'd take you with me for a little walk on the beach. So this, if you were watching live this morning, you will have seen me pick all these things up. So I've given them a wash, just to smell bleach, in some bleach, and I've put them here ready to show you. So that's the little bit of wood that I thought was particularly nice. So I'm going to put that in the wood stash. And I've got a selection of oyster shells, which I found. I thought that would look like somebody taking a bite out today. Just put all the little around like that. I'm getting it. Round of applause for T-Boy.
Afternoon, everybody. I'm a little bit busy today.
He's got the rest of his pictures to make for the Pleasure Beach. So he's in the basement. Yeah, so I found some nice oyster shells. And they polish up and look really pretty as well. Look how that's twinkling. Oh, greetings from Thailand. I bet it's considerably warmer in Thailand than it is here. It's Paul Williams' birthday today, so happy birthday, Paul. I've got some comments and some shout-outs, which I'll read out in a minute when we get to them. So I thought we'd finish off the beach first. So then we had a discussion about what they're called, because I couldn't for the life in me remember what one of those is in its entirety. Somebody else said a conch, but it's not a conch. A conch is, this is my little bit box of stash things. A conch shell is more that sort of shape, but bigger. That's a keeper's conch, that one. This is a bit of that. That's got a hole in the top as well. So that, I thought that was pretty. It just caught my eye, I just thought it was pretty. This is a bit of sea glass, which is actually the rim of a bottle. Can you see the curve on it there? So that's been a bottle at some point. Sea glass part two, still to come, the movie. And this has to be today's star find. Are you ready? Yeah! That looks like me when I'm on one. This morning that it's a go on, finger puppet, that's the word I'm looking for, which I suppose it could be. I don't really want to put my finger inside it, because despite the fact it's been bleaching in bleach, it's got a bit of a mucky interior, but I thought it was, yeah, that's me when I haven't had a cuppa in the morning either, but I thought it was quite a ugly little thing, so I popped that in my stash. So that's what we found between us on the beach this morning. So John says that they go on a pencil. No, it's too big for a pencil, John. That's definitely finger shaped. So there you go. So, can I say hello to all Paul and Diane's family? Well, I've got a shout out from Paul and Diane. If anybody wants any shout outs or anything asking or anything saying or anything, finger bobs, that's the thing. Can you please send me an email, because I get dozens, well, hundreds of emails, messages, random things on a daily basis. And we've been doing this long enough for you to understand that I've got a memory like a sieve. So if I read something on a Facebook message, that's if I see it, the odds on chance of me actually remembering to do something with it are nil. So always send me an email, Jane, J-A-N-E, at therabbitpatch.co.uk, and that's in the description as well below the video. So Paul and Diane from Bartley Green, they did as requested. Yes, everybody smash the like button. Make sure you've done that. At least, no, I was going to say at least once, but if you do it twice, it'll delete it, so just once. So Paul says, I'm loving the videos, could you please give my beautiful wife Diane a shout out? She is a fantastic wife and I love her. That lovely. Kindest regards and love to you from Paul and Diane Williams from Bartley Green in Birmingham. So there you go, that's Paul and Diane, and Paul's just told us it's his birthday. So happy birthday. If you're good, I'll not sing to you. Right, so this one is another one from, no, it's not my age rules, I've always had a memory like a sieve. I've always had to write everything down. this is from the other side of the world. This is from Lynn and Brian, and they live in Australia. I'm not exactly sure. Surfers Paradise in Australia. And I bet it's a lot warmer there than it is in Cleveland. So, Lynn and Brian say, we're two of your loyal subscribers. We're originally from Blackpool and retired and living the dream in Surfers Paradise in Australia. We used to live in the Revo area, where their mother still lives, hence the reason for getting in touch. So, we would all like to wish a very happy birthday to, my mother. I'm not sure whether that's Lynn's mother or Brian's mother. We would like to wish a happy birthday to Ethel Watkin. She's 99 tomorrow.
Wow.
Yay! Well done, Ethel. That's an age to reach. Yeah, you're younger than T-Boy. Younger than T-Boy. So, they're enjoying watching Brewer 2, and obviously they're watching Tom catch up because it's a different time zone. So if you can see it, this is Lynn and Brian. And last week I nearly killed myself laughing when I thought somebody was suggesting that we should be doing Zumba. And apparently they do Zumba and they think it's really good and we should all try it. Not on Brewer 2. There you go. So that's that one. Right, and the other one is a photo of Stephen from Darlington, who was brave and sent us in a picture with his Brewitt tool mug. So there you go, there's quite a lot of you got a Brewitt tool mug. So we're quite a big gang of bats. That's all I've got to say. So well done, Stephen, for sending that in. And I'm actually, Eric, if you're wanting to make a note of this, or record it or something, or whatever it was you were doing that was funny. Last week I read Eric's poem out about yoga. And as I was saying about the Zumba, somebody killed themselves laughing. Well, I killed myself laughing when somebody I thought had suggested that we should be doing Zumba right in the middle of Eric's poem. So apologies to you for that, Eric, but I will read it again and then we can do it with a straight face and everybody can listen properly because I'm naughty. I shouldn't have done that. It just startled me. It was a good job I wasn't drinking my tea because I should have gone and spat it all over the phone, wouldn't I? If I had been drinking my tea at the time. But before we get to that, it's a lovely sunny day in the West Midlands, June says. Well, I can't believe that.
We should have put my bone sand down.
Yes! When we were on the beach the other day, I asked you what you were doing at the weekend, and a couple of you said that you were going gardening. Carrie was going in her allotment, and I made the comment that you'd all need your Eljex and your Radium B when you'd finished. Anyway. I put T-Boy in training on a three-line whip and told him that we were going in the garden at the weekend because our green bin's being emptied today. So I wanted to get a lot of chopping down done and into the bin so it could be gone. So out we went, and I got various other things to do, including a pile of ironing. So when we'd finished doing, I was sort of instructing him, as you do with men that find it difficult to. Oh, hello Pearl. Colin's got his mum with her. Can I say hello to Pearl? Hello Pearl. Yeah, so I stood there and I had my pointy stick. I usually get a cane and I start pointing. Cut that to there, in a straight line. I don't want it any further forward than that. Do this, do that. So you can imagine, you know, you can see how it went on round the garden. So it got to about, pardon? T-Boy says, you sound just like your mother. So it got to about 3 o'clock and I said, right, that's it, I've had enough now. I'm off in, I'm going to go and do my ironing. The only iron what needs ironing, Christine. So off I trundled and I left him with a list of things that I wanted him to do. Now I asked him to do various different things. I asked him to fasten a rose bush up and a tree because it's going to be very windy tomorrow and I didn't want them to break in the wind. Has he done it? No. I asked him to fasten a great big bay tree up and cut the top off it. I bought it about that big in one of those little plastic bags from the supermarket when we very first bought this house. It is now beyond the gutter. So I said to him, cut that down and fasten that branch up because it's going to be windy on Wednesday. I don't want it to break. Has he done it? No. So then I also said to him, don't forget to put the lawn sand on because it's going to rain on Wednesday and the rain will wash it in. Has he done it? No. Men, what can you say? What can you say?
I'm sorry.
I think you ought to come out of behind there, Kevin, and make a full formal apology.
I'm sorry.
So am I. I know Brenda's watching and anybody else that knows Kevin that's watching will be laughing now and knowing that this...
They'll know why, exactly.
Because this is a scenario that's repeated, I would say on a daily basis, but possibly hourly. In that you give a simple instruction and say, please do this. And what do you get? The opposite. So, there you go. As you can see, I'm laughing as I'm saying this because I wouldn't be without him. I'd just do protest change. Oh, I'm getting warm now. I said that. Right. So, on to some questions now that that people have sent in. So I've got two questions that have been sent in by readers. So Phil has made a comment, and somebody else actually made pretty much the same comment. I think it was Lynn. Oh, that could be the phone.
I'll have it back.
So Phil says, do I know when work is going to start on the dock area in Fleetwood?
Yeah.
Answer to that, apparently, if you're talking about Project Neptune, which is the restoration of one part of the dock, that's supposed to be working from this sort of spring onwards. So we'll see whether or not that transpires. And the other question that Phil asked was, Sidlittle, off the television. Just a minute, I do struggle to... I've been terrible in an open plan office. I'll come back to your question in a second, Phil, when he's sorted that out.
Yeah.
You're very welcome, Paul. You're very welcome to that.
What is your name again, sorry?
If I worked in an open plan office, I'd be absolutely shocking, honestly. Right. Are we right? Sidlittle, from Little and Large, has put the steam pub Sid from Little and Large show in 80s. He or his wife work there. Can you find out if they still work there? I know they live near Fleetwood. Well, I think there's several questions in that actually, Phil. Number one, Little and Large, yes, Sid does live in Fleetwood. Is a really, really nice man. I've had the pleasure of meeting him several times, and I actually did an interview with him several years ago. I think it was when he celebrated his 50th anniversary in show business. And I honestly was killing myself laughing at him. Really, really, really nice bloke. And he and his wife runs the restaurant at the Steamer Pub, which is on the front. Now, I think it's Queen's Terrace. It's on that corner where you go to the market, and I can never remember where Queen's Terrace ends and Dorr Street begins, but it's on that corner. And I think it's one of the oldest buildings in Fleetwood as well. It's a very, very old pub. And his wife, Sherry, runs the restaurant, and he does the kind of front of house and the serving and whatnot. And obviously it's closed at the minute, but to the very best of my knowledge, they do still hold residence. And Lynn also asked the same question for Lynn. And you quite often see him pottering about in Beverley's and Fleetwood and getting his shopping and whatnot. And it's really nice. And he's so nice. Such a nice bloke. So that's that one. That answers your questions, I think, Phil. And then I've had another one from Elizabeth, who is related to the Kemp family. Now, this came out in sort of two or three dribs and drabs as well, because Elizabeth in the first place said that she'd married a man called Peter Kemp, and his roots were in Kent, but he died in 2014. And when her son had been in Fleetwood for a while, he sent her a picture of Frederick Kemp of Fleetwood and asked me who I thought it looked like. From the nose upwards, he looked like my husband, so I started to trace back into my husband's family tree and also into Frederick's family tree, but I can't find a link to join one to the other. Her son's done his DNA, and she's done her DNA, but not many people with the name of Kemp seem to have done it to find a match in the database. And she'd love to find out whether anybody in the filed area has a link to Frederick, and if there's a sideways connection to join the families together. So, could I say something about it on Brewer 2 and see whether or not anybody knows? Well, you've probably heard me mentioning a fascinating tome written by a guy called Nick Moore, and he's a local historian, and he's done the most interesting history of Blackpool and the Fylde Coast, and it dates back to kind of like 300-400 AD. The dot, for all intents and purposes. So I had a look in Nick's work. There's a link to it usually in the description underneath most of the videos. And Frederick Kemp was Sir Peter Hesketh Fleetwood's land agent. And he was also Fleetwood's first postmaster. And apparently by the mid-1940s his wealth had overtaken that of Peter Hesketh Fleetwood, because he owned the Steam Navigation Company. Now, I replied this to Elizabeth, and she already knew that bit, because obviously she's done quite a bit of digging in their family tree. And apparently, it sounds like Frederick Kemp was kind of, you know, doing these sorts of bits and sidelining things, deals into his own pocket that perhaps should have been going towards Peter Hesketh Fleetwood. And there is a Kemp Street in Fleetwood, which is off, it's between Dock Street and Law Street, and it goes down the side of where Peacock's is. There's Peacock's and then the church on the other side of the road. So if anybody on replay that watches this knows the answer, please can you get in touch and let us know, and then we can pass it on to Elizabeth, because I think that's very interesting. So before we get on to poems, another slurp. I don't want my tea to go cold in my delightful brew to a mug. Two things. Christine mentioned Finger Bob's. Yes, Ross, he doesn't own the pub. His wife runs the restaurant. He doesn't own the pub, actually. You've mixed me up there, because there's a consortium of them in Fleetwood that own a number of different pubs. It might be one of them, but his wife definitely runs a restaurant. Right, somebody mentioned Finger Bob's. And if you're my age, or you've got children my age, you'll remember Finger Bob's. Can you remember watching that? It was a puppet show, and they were like little finger puppets, and the guy that did it, he used to stand there with these little finger puppets. It's little Finger Bob's, and it's just, you know, simple, easy programmes. If you can't remember Finger Bob's, look it up on YouTube and you'll find Finger Bob's on there. Eric, Little and Large. I know you've not had a television for a long time, but I'm amazed you can't remember Little and Large. Eddie Large died recently, he had COVID in the end, I believe. And they were absolutely well-known, famous comedians. They were larger than large. Look it up on YouTube. No, I can't see any sea out of the window. Sorry, Aldo, sees that way. And somebody asked, while I was prattling, whether we'd got somebody feeding the seagulls on the roof with a bag of chips. No, we've not got somebody feeding them. That's Homer and his new wife, Gladys. I mentioned Gladys once or twice before, and she's a right strumpet. Honestly, you've never seen a brass-necked bird like it. She is. She's a harlot. So, it's nearly cold. Can I just finish it? I'll be close on it. Ah, They sit somewhere around our vicinity, keeping an eye on proceedings, watching to see what we're doing, and demanding food on a regular basis, basically. So, as you know, T-Boy's been downstairs doing his Pleasure Beach pictures. And there's a big window, and we've got kind of a void at the bottom of the stairs that we use for all kinds of different things. So he's got a table set up, and he's sat there with his production line and his boxes, and there's this big window. So the seagulls, Homer has always stood outside that window, banging on the window. I actually pay him to get Kevin out of bed in the morning in food. And he bangs on the window, it's true. And honestly, if you heard him banging on the window, this is what he does. Like that. Really loud. Until you go and feed him. So we also sit up here, so I've got, you can just see the edge of them, there's a window above my desk. So he sits on here and he looks over the edge into the window, and then he starts tapping on this window, so obviously when it's a window you get more of a... And then they sit on the fence, they sit on the front, they sit on the wall, they sit basically wherever they can see. So it's those two that are yapping. And then when we go out with the food, they strike up, fetch every seagull for miles around, and then usually just sit there and wait for somebody else to eat it all. They're just a bit stupid, I think. So, Bats, I have a treat for you now. Are you ready? This is why I turned the sound up on my computer, because Jane, who goes by the name of Astonished Celt, has actually read out her poem, and she sent me a recording. So hopefully this will work. If I'm going to play it, and I've turned the sound right up on my computer. If it doesn't work and you can't hear it properly, please write a comment and then I can stop it and I'll read it out myself. Are you ready? We shall begin. This is Aquatic Ogre by Jane. I shall play. Are you ready?
Hello everyone, it's Astonished Celt here from Staffordshire. I hope you're keeping well. I'm reading my poem to you today, entitled Aquatic Ogre. Hefted to the sand, ogre never strays. Carved in limestone of 15 gruesome tons. Gladly embraced with photosynthetic glaze. Blinded from whiskey and red eyes, he's stunned. Hurled out of your throne on Russell Beach. Waiting in his holding pen for the waves. Hours are hollow without anything to teach. Twice a day his liquid grave he braves. Abyssed with fish for half of your day. With sea abated, children are elated. Your wicked reputation is to slay. Aquatic ogre myth is awaited. Seaward end of the groin you are bound. Children stand and stare when you're around. Thank you for listening. Love, peace to all. Bye now.
That's brilliant, that Jane. That's really good. And somebody, I'll turn the sound off now, and then if it starts pinging, it'll not annoy us all. Somebody suggested a week or two ago that we ought to do a book of poems written by you guys and illustrated by T-Boy. So I think we might put that on the list of things to do. It's not me that's brilliant, Maria. It's Jane. I can't take any credit for that. Right. So now I'm going to read out Eric's poem again, because I cobbled it into last week when I was worrying about doing Zumba. So Eric has written a poem called The Ogre's Picnic, and this is to the tune of Teddy Bear's Picnic. Do you want me to sing it, John? Perhaps not. Are you ready? Right, I shall begin. The Ogre's Picnic by Eric Friesinger. If you go down to the beach tonight, you'll hardly believe your eyes. The ogre has left the ground behind and the tide is on the rise. For every mermaid ever there was will gather there for certain, because tonight's the time the ogre has a picnic. Picnic time for King Neptune. His dolphins and crabs are having a lovely time today. Watch him catch him unawares and see him frolic on ogre's holiday. If you go down to the beach tonight, you're sure of a big surprise. If you go down to the beach tonight, you'd better go in disguise. Every mermaid who's been good is sure of a treat today. There's lots of marvellous things to eat and wonderful games to play. Beneath the seas where nobody sees, they'll hide and tickle the ogre's knees. For tonight, the night of Cleveland's festive picnic. See, octopuses gadd about, they love to make the ogre shout. When they catch him unawares, at midnight the tide goes out, leaving seagrass behind. Especially for our host, Jane Rabbit, to seek and find. I have something I prepared earlier. There you go. I think that's very good. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist the temptation to be slightly tuneful. You'd have hysterics if you lived in our house. More ways than one, I must admit. But everything that everybody says, we end up singing. Honestly, it never stops. It starts in the morning when we get out of bed, and it finishes when we go to bed at night. Christine's got her mum's tambourine, she could have joined in. So somebody will say something perfectly innocent, and it, you know, it's a case of cue for a song, and off we go, and then that's it. Oh, singing that for the next hour. And somebody will say something else, and off we go in another direction, singing something else completely entirely. And it never stops, it's all day long. I really, 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 really want to go to the range. And every time I think about going to the range, I start singing Home on the Range. I can do the phone. So So then I end up spending all day singing Home on the Range, where the deer and the antelope play. And then that carries on for the next 3 hours. So there you go, you see, it's all good fun. It's a laugh a minute in our house. So, any questions, anybody? Anybody got anything else to say? Has anybody got any comments? Because I think we're just about getting ready for our swan song. If you've not got any other things to say, Kevin's just gone to attend to the man from Sainsbury's. We swapped our delivery to 2 while 3 because it was more convenient. It allowed him to have time to wash the pots before the delivery comes. There you go. Yes, this is your weekly pickup, Michael. A little bit of fun and entertainment to break the week up. So, we're going to finish on our swan song, as we always do. It'd be on the X Factor. They'd have me on the X Factor sweeping up. I think that'd be it. It would be a very, very miserable afternoon. It'd be a very miserable life if we didn't enjoy music. And you know what they say, sing like nobody's listening. Right, this is our swan song to finish on. And this poem is Smile, written by Spike Milligan. Are you ready? Yeah. Smiling is infectious, you catch it like the flu. When someone smiled at me today, I started smiling too. I passed around the corner and someone saw my grin. When he smiled, I realised I passed it on to him. I thought about that smile and realised it's worth a single smile, just like mine, could travel around the earth. So if you feel a smile begin, don't leave it undetected. Let's start an epidemic, quick, and get the world infected. Bye for this week, folks, from Jane the Sea Glass.